guys, welcome back to Home Built. Last week you saw me get the steering geometry all set up. This week we actually have to mount it to the car. Okay, those of you watching last week will have seen that I spent a lot of time working out how I was going to convert this car from a steering box to a steering rack. And I put in the Toyota rack, I flipped over the steering arms from side to side on this car and played around until I got the bump steer exactly where I want it, and I got bang on perfect bump steer. Now, I've done a little bit more research into how I was going to do it. I was temporarily using these rod ends to connect up to the steering arm. That's not a great way of doing it. It's okay for a race car, but it's open to the elements, so you can get dirt and grit and stuff in there and it can get damaged. I've managed to find that these tie rods, these Toyota tie rods, are actually the same thread as Nissan S13 tie rods, and there's lots of drift car parts available, and it's quite readily available to get some adjustable bump steer tie rod ends. So they've actually got some height adjustments, so I can play around with them when I get them. They're also sealed and they've got a wider range of movement, which this doesn't. What I'm going to do with these arms, because I've turned them up the other way, they normally have a tapered fit. The taper at the moment, because I've turned them upside down, the taper is going down, which is not what I want. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to weld up the hole, re-drill it out, and then put the taper in from the opposite end. I'll do that later when I get the tie rod ends. But for the time being, we are going to concentrate on the rack. So I've got the rack in the right spot. So now I need to get the engine back out of the car so I can actually make up some brackets so I can hold the steering rack in the car. Alright, so I've spent a fair bit of time now getting this steering rack in exactly the right spot. This is on the exact right angle that I need, and I've gone through and there's the boss here that actually clamps the steering rack on in the factory. I'm going to reuse that, and I've made this little piece of cardboard here. Basically what I've taken is this piece of square tube is the bracket that I'm going to use. I'm going to make brackets out of this square tubing. I made a little template piece of cardboard the same size as that bracket, and then I've trimmed this little tiny triangle almost piece of cardboard that sits perfectly in line with the bracket, onto the bracket and onto my subframe here, and that is the basis for how I'm going to start bolting this on. All right, now I'm going to also use some round tube. I want to say a quick thank you to all the patrons who helped get me a new toy for the garage. So thank you very much to the patrons. If you want to be a patron, you can click the link in the description and help assist making things better and quicker and getting things like this. So this is gonna save me a lot of time and hopefully make some nice clean cuts on some metal. So let's start slicing off a couple of bits of tube so I can move forward on making these mounts. Alright, so I've spent a lot of time going backwards and forwards with making this bracket that it looks a little bit weird, but this perfectly clips onto the bottom cross member of the car, and the other side mounts perfectly onto this steering rack so that I can get it in the exact right position. So this distance is all perfect, so it clips on in the exact right spot. All the measurements are exactly where I want it. Now, I did do a bit of a sketch. I've sort of made this very clear, easy to decipher sketch that you can see there. It's a scribble, but that's what I'm gonna try to build. So I'm going to be using these original mounting points for this steering rack using the original rubber, using this boss, which is squared off. I need to keep that so that obviously the steering rack doesn't twist when it's in the car. and throw bits away, and it will be held nice and solid in the perfect spot. So that's what I'm doing. Let's continue to cut up a few bits and pieces now, and I'll explain what I'm doing along the way. Okay, so after lots of playing around, I just got on the drill press and did some drills. It's starting to look like the piece it's supposed to. So you can sort of see there that it makes roughly a D shape. And that is to match up with the D shape that is on this steering rack itself to mount it into the car. What I've done, I've cut out different pieces of box section and made it so that this top part will be one piece. The bottom part will bolt on either side here, and that's the bracket that holds the rack onto the car, and that's how you can remove it by just sort of clipping it up and down and bolting it on. So that is the basic principle, but at the moment it's all hollow and open, and that is not strong enough. I want a nice strong solid steering rack on the car, and what I'm going to be doing is I've got, this is just a piece of box section that I've cut up. This fits perfectly into the top section, and I have in here somewhere these pieces of steel pipe that I got, which is the right diameter, internal diameter, to cap onto these parts of the rack. I deliberately went and found stuff the right size so that I can weld these bits inside my brackets so that I have a nice solid sturdy bracket that's reinforced all the way around, be nice and solid. It's not going to move anywhere. That's what I want for the car. So I'm going to reassemble this now and tack it together, and then we can see if it'll actually hold up. And and of course my favorite captive nuts are going into the inside, so I'll weld these nuts in, and then we can see if this actually fits and does what it's supposed to do. All right, that was a lot of work to get this just tacked together, but I actually have my bracket all bolted up onto my steering rack, so now it's time to check it in the car, make sure it all lines up, and then I have to make the other side. The other side should be a bit simpler because it's just round. This one was the complicated shape, so hopefully it's simpler. So after all that, I messed up. And basically I made all this time to make this bracket fit perfectly, and the issue was is that when I have that bracket fitting perfectly around that subframe, the rack is twisted too far forward. I've built this all now, so I'm not going to change this bit because this is the hard bit. So what I'm going to do, basically I need to have it at about that angle, something up like that. So I'm going to cut off this piece and then re-weld it on the angle I need. It's a pain, but this is just part and parcel of how this all comes together. It's slow and tedious, but this is what's required to get it to all fit properly. All right, the basic bracket for this one was much, much faster. Now I knew what I was doing, and this is just a very, very simple, very simple version of what this end is. That's good. So now it's time to start trying to make this long bit fit up to the subframe of the actual car. That's going to be the more difficult part. All right, so I've gone now, I've added the internal parts to my bracket so that they fit much nicer to the car. I've just got the rack up now. I've got it all ready to go. I'm gonna bolt it back in the car, hopefully for the last time, hopefully it all fits up, and then I can weld these brackets up solid and then hopefully tack it to the car and test it with the engine. Still a lot to do, so time consuming. Finally, the brackets are finally good, which means I can start welding them up solid and finally fit them to the car. Well, I've got my brackets all welded up. I actually ran out of TIG welding gas before I got it to finish the last one. This one's still probably pretty hot, but I had to finish it off with the MIG. Ouch, that's hot. Really hot. You can see here, I much prefer the TIG to finish this stuff up. It's much more delicate, doesn't add so much material. The MIG really adds a lot of material, and it's you can get sort of the penetration and finesse it much better with the TIG. And it's got nice penetration through to the back of all of these welds as well. So these are nice and super strong. So I have my brackets all made up. Okay, and after a bit of grinding, I've got these brackets looking nice and neat and tidy, all welded up, except for one of them. I still need to get the more gas for the TIG so I can finish it up and make it as neat as the others are. But that is all the time I have. They've taken so much time to get them looking nice and neat and tidy. It's worth taking the time to do it though and getting it right, because this is one of the important things on the car to get right. I will note that this is going to be currently the lowest part of the car. It's actually, the rack is now sitting below that bottom subframe, which sounds terrible, but the fact is on this car, I'm gonna have to have the exhaust sitting lower. And on the original car, the sump of the engine actually sat in front of that bottom subframe section, and it was actually, the sump was the lowest part of the car, which is a really bad thing because it was a cast sump originally on the Alpha 105s, which was, if you hit a bump hard, it was very prone to cracking and just disintegrating, as opposed to a sheet metal one, which might get a dent and you might survive. Anyway, I will have to put some sort of bump strip in there. Either way, that is all the time I have. I'm out of TIG gas, so I'm gonna have to do that and sort that out next week. So I think that's time for Fun Facts with Mrs. Jeff.
Hi guys. Last week we talked about the Alfa Romeo Sprint, and that car was the base for a very interesting car built in Australia. Giacattolo Motori was founded in 1986 by sports car enthusiast Paul Halstead and Formula One designer Barry Lock. The Giacattolo, which means toy in Italian, was based on the Sprint but was fitted with a 2.5-litre Busso V6, which was mid-mounted behind the driver. The project costs blew out, with expensive parts and Alfa Romeo threatening legal action, and the company folded in 1989, with only 15 cars ever being made. The best known of these owned by Todd Wilkes, came to a very unfortunate and fatal end. Todd Wilkes built up his Gia Catolo with a twin-turbo LS1 V8, and it made an excess of 800 horsepower. It was known as the Judge. At Sydney's Eastern Creek Raceway in 2001, at a poorly run event called Terminal Velocity, he reached 281 kilometres an hour. Before trying to brake hard, he couldn't make it, his brakes locked up, and he slid into the wall, ending his life in a fiery crash. Jeff was actually on his way to that event, and he remembers on the radio it being cancelled because of Todd Wilkes' death.
Well, it's another week where it feels like I spent lots of time doing very little, but I've got my brackets mostly made up, and the steering is going to be in the right spot, I hope. I still haven't tested it with the engine, but that was a day and a half of work just to build those little brackets. Really, really time consuming.
It sure was. Yeah, lots of noise.
But we're chipping away at it, and I'm quite positive it's going well. So
yeah, you're getting there. It's great. It's great. Yeah. All right, please like and subscribe if you haven't already done so. We really like knowing that you're enjoying watching Jeff.
Yeah, please comment below as well. We read everything. Thank you again to the patrons for helping out and helping me get some new tools in the garage. And if you guys want to help out and watch the videos a day early, you can also join us on Patreon. Link's in the description. It really does help. All right, guys. Well, we'll see you in the next one. See you guys.
Yes. Drive out designer. Okay, they're different. They're very different, right? Toy in Italian to install, and it was replaced with the Holden V5 Turbo LS horsepower.
Yes.
Oh yeah. Yes, you got it. Get it in.